I'd like to tell you what this referendum is not. It's not a vote on the morality of abortion, which is an individual's decision rather than a political one. Here's what the referendum is. An opportunity for the Irish people to say, we're prepared to support women, girls, couples, families, after they've made the intensely personal decision to have an abortion. The choice facing all of us is a simple one. Are we going to continue turning our backs on people, depriving them of support? Or are we compassionate and mature enough to care for them in their own country at a difficult time? Morality and choice are personal issues, but appropriate, supervised, non-judgmental, safe healthcare is something we can and should provide. Ireland of 2018 is unrecognisable compared with 1983, except in the case of our abortion laws, which remain resistant to a woman's best interests. Thanks to the Citizens Assembly and the Oireachtas Health Committee, the people now have facts they didn't have 35 years ago. Facts which cannot be disputed. Facts about girls who were raped or subjected to incest going to England to have abortions. A horrific journey for a lonely, frightened girl to make. Facts about the prevalence of abortion pills, which are easy to buy on the internet and are being taken without supervision. A healthcare risk. Facts about couples where the woman is carrying a baby with no prospect of life, yet is obliged to leave the jurisdiction to access basic medical care. Nobody here is recommending forced abortions. What we're saying is abortion ought to be a deeply personal, private choice. So, today is a good day. It's a day when we're saying, time to end the hypocrisy. Time to stop looking the other way. Time to stand by women in crisis pregnancies. Time to do right by our neighbours, our colleagues, our friends, our daughters, our sisters. So we're now going to hear from an extraordinary couple who are campaigners with termination for medical reasons. Their names are Jerry and Gay Edwards. They have been generous and courageous in sharing their story about how the Eighth Amendment affected their lives when Gay was pregnant with their son Joshua. The couple received a devastating diagnosis and had to travel to Belfast to access healthcare that ought to have been available to them closer to home. I'd like to invite them now onto the stage.
Talk to you all day really about the circumstances that have led us to where we are now. Our time is limited, so I'll give you the potted version. In order to do that, I'm going to take you back to 18 years ago. It was the new millennium. We were newly married. We had moved into our new house and we were mad keen to start a family. So that's what we embarked upon. And just about at the time of our first anniversary, we got the positive test and we were absolutely delighted. It was a relatively uneventful pregnancy for the first half. And we got to the 20-week scan and we're very excited at the idea of getting in and seeing our baby and asking all the questions. So the sonographer started scanning and she showed us things like the sole of the foot and the spine and the heartbeat was really important. And she took a picture for us of the hand on the side of the face like this. And I wonder, was she checking to see if we noticed anything? Because she had been very chatty. But shortly after this photo, she said that she was a bit concerned that the bone shows up white on a scan and she wasn't seeing everything that she should around the head. She said she was going to have to go and get a consultant. So we had a bit of a clue that things weren't all right at that stage. We stayed in silence in the room while she went to get the consultant because I was afraid if I looked at Jerry that I would just fall to pieces and I needed to hold it together. So the on-duty obstetrician came in and started taking measurements and this was very different to the midwife, the specialist midwife, because while she had been chatting through and showing us the last few minutes of normality with our baby, the obstetrician did all his work in complete silence. And at the end he asked me to get dressed and to follow him. She took us in to what I call the bad news room. It's just a small room with a box of tissues on the table. And he said to us that our baby had a condition called anencephaly. We had never heard of it. And he said it was a neural tube defect, that it was a fatal condition incompatible with life. And he went on to tell us that we could continue with the pregnancy, that we could come every 2 weeks to check for a heartbeat, and at the end of the pregnancy, that I would go into labor, give birth, and they would take care of me. He said in this jurisdiction, that was our only option. And that was the only clue that we had, that there might be another option. We really wanted, with all due respect to the professionalism of the obstetricians, we really wanted for him to be wrong. So we went home and started looking up miracle cures and revolutionary treatment with the keyword anencephaly in there. But we had to accept that in fact he was right. There was no hope. There was no prospect of life. So we had to consider our options, or start considering our options. And what I could think of at that stage was the practicalities of continuing going into work every day, working in an environment where there were other people at the same stage as we were in our lives that were embarking on pregnancy, of building families, where already, I mean, I was halfway through a pregnancy, I was not huge, but obvious. And in Ireland, as anybody who has ever been pregnant will know, you're public property, and people are quite comfortable coming and asking you how it's going. Things like, have you got any furniture ready? Have you got the room ready? Do you know if it's a boy or a girl? And the thought of fielding these questions when I knew there was no prospect of a live baby at the end of it was hugely daunting. So the thought of even leaving my house was overwhelming.
We spoke about our options with our GP. We asked if we could get an amniocentesis, but we couldn't get one in Ireland at that time, I think because of the risk of inducing a miscarriage. So we asked our consultant for a letter of referral, and we're given a handwritten letter to whom it may concern. There's no copy on our medical file, because the file didn't go to a typing pool, and I think that's a clear indication that our consultant was concerned that they would be ratted out for helping somebody to avail of the termination of pregnancy overseas. We ended up visiting a geneticist abroad in Belfast for an amniocentesis, and they confirmed the diagnosis to us again, and they referred us to the local maternity hospital, the Royal Victoria, who again confirmed the diagnosis. The consultant we met there discussed all of our options with us, and he asked us what is it we wanted to do. And this was the first time we met a doctor who was free to ask us what did we want to do. We knew we wanted to bring the pregnancy to an end, and we made an appointment for 3 days' time. We were told that we were under absolutely no obligation to proceed, and that we were free to change, that we were contacting to free up the delivery suite for another couple.
Well, my mother came with us. So it was the three of us that travelled. And one of the most surprising things, shouldn't have been, one of the most surprising things was the kindness, the care and the compassion that was shown to us by the hospital staff, the medical staff in Belfast. It came time, once I was settled in, for me to take the medication that would start the labour, that would lead. I was like 22 weeks at this stage. And as it happened, when it arrived with my lunch, and Jerry and my mum had left the room, so I was sitting on my own, and I just couldn't help notice that this just compounded the isolation that I felt. I pushed them around with a spoon. Not because there was any doubt in my mind that it was the right thing to do for me, but because I knew that once I took these two tablets, that there was no going back. So I went ahead. I knew it was the right decision for me, and I went ahead with it. But I was also afraid of the prospect of labour, because it was my first pregnancy. And when you're facing labour under normal circumstances, you know what the reward is at the end of it. I knew that there was no prospect of me producing, of me having a live baby at the end of this.
When Joshua was born, he was silent. There was only the sound of us crying in the room that morning. I have to say that the staff in Belfast were wonderful. They took our son away, they cleaned him and dressed him. They took photos and footprints for us. And they placed him in a Moses basket, I beg your pardon, in a blanket, ready for us to view him. And it struck me that the dignity and respect that was shown to both us and to our son was in stark contrast to the complete abandonment that we felt from our own doctors and from our own country.
There came a point the next day where we knew we were going to have to leave. The hospital were at pains to say to us that there was no rush, we could take our time, take as long as we wanted. But the anticipation of knowing that we were going to have to leave was almost worse than the actual moment where we had to gather up our things, leave the hospital, and leave him behind. It was one of the, I have to say it was actually out of all awful moments in those few days, in that 2 weeks, that was the worst.
Having to take my wife away the next day and leave our dead son behind was the hardest thing I've ever had to do. And I didn't feel like a good husband or a good father in doing that. We were unable to attend his cremation because the hospital didn't know when it would be. And about 2 weeks later, we received his ashes by courier. Gay and I were at home alone at the time. And I had to sign for my son's remains like I would for any other delivery. And I actually remember feeling sorry for the delivery man because he clearly had no idea what he was handing over to me.
I've often wondered in the 17 years since if I had spoken out earlier, if I had put my face and my name out there, would we be where we are now? 10 years ago, 15 years ago. And it haunts me that there are women going through this today. There are women in another part of this building who are going to get the news that I did today. And nothing's changed. Nothing has changed. I have to satisfy myself that the time is right now, that maybe things wouldn't have moved 10 years or so ago.
In addition to losing Joshua, timing carefully, we lost another 5 babies to miscarriage. But I'm pleased to say that we have 4 wonderful children today, 2 boys and girls. We went to hell and back to get those children. It's a journey I wouldn't wish on my worst enemy, but I would do it again in the morning to have the family that I have now. As a young man growing up, I never thought that abortion would affect me, but it has. It can affect us all, either directly or indirectly, to the people that we love. And all of the discussion that we've been having recently, or a lot of discussion, has measured a successful outcome of pregnancy on the basis of whether a woman survives it or dies. I think that's an extremely low bar. I know that my wife and my children are worth more than simply their lives, and so are yours. I value their health. I value their happiness and well-being. I love them, I trust them, and I respect them. There are no circumstances under which I would force any woman or young girl to continue a pregnancy if they did not wish to. We've moved on from dropping our pregnant at the gates of the laundries. And I think as a society, we need to move on from dropping them at the departure gates too. We're calling on all women and men to move away from our shameful legacy of judgment and abandonment, and to take this opportunity to create a caring, compassionate society that better reflects who we are as a people. And we're asking everybody to come together with us on Referendum Day on behalf of all those that we love and vote yes. Thank you.
Speaker is Dr. Peter Boylan. He's chair of the Institute of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. Peter is a former master of the National Maternity Hospital, and he has personally delivered more than 6,000 babies during his career. I've just asked him if that means there are hundreds of little boys running around the country with Peter as a middle name, but he doesn't know. Dr. Boylan, I should say, is a much valued champion for women's reproductive healthcare rights, and we'll hear from him now.
Thanks very much, Martina. I almost don't need to say anything after listening to Gay and Jerry and their extraordinarily brave testimony to you today. However, I am going to address the issues that I've been asked to talk about, and that really is why we should repeal the Eighth Amendment from a medical person's point of view. I think it's true to say that the Eighth Amendment has caused grave harm to many women in Ireland, including death. And manifestly, it has not achieved the original aim of its supporters, which was to prevent women in Ireland having abortions. Women in Ireland access abortion in one of two ways today. Either they travel to another country, or they buy pills online illegally and with no certainty as to their quality. These pills are safe and effective when taken under medical supervision, as is the case in virtually every other country in Europe. However, when they are taken without medical supervision, there are significant risks. Doctors are concerned about this. In 1983, the Institute of Obstetricians and Gynecologists did not have an official position on the Eighth Amendment. 35 years later, having seen at first hand the unintended and unforeseen consequences of the Eighth, the Institute has an agreed position. We want to see the Eighth Amendment repealed. And we respect it. Respectfully ask the Irish people to say yes to repeal in the forthcoming amendment referendum. So why are we advocating for repeal? We believe that it harms women and adversely impacts the practice of obstetrics. We heard clearly from Jerry and Gay an example of that. And I don't know if many of you would have heard the Morning Ireland testimony a couple of days ago, which was absolutely heartbreaking, but that is the reality today in this country. I want to give you just two examples in recent years which I have personal experience of. The first is the death of Savita Halapanavar in 2012. And for those of you who can't remember the role of the Eighth Amendment in her death, let me quote her treating consultant in Galway. At Savita's inquest, the senior counsel put to her, "May we infer that if these dreadful events occurred in a neighbouring country, that Savita would have had her termination on Monday, or perhaps on the Tuesday, upon request or at your next elective list?" And Savita's treating consultant replied, "Yes. Patients are usually offered the option. My understanding is, under 20 weeks in countries where termination is permitted, patients are usually offered the option of either termination or continuation of the pregnancy." Senior counsel then asked, "So just by a geographical mischance, Savita found herself in this dreadful situation?" And her consultant answered, "Well, that's the law in this country. And doctors have to obey the law." There is a cause of death on every death certificate, and Savita died of sepsis. That is absolutely correct. The source of her sepsis was in her womb, but as her consultant said, in any other European country, apart from Malta, Savita would have been offered a termination of pregnancy in order to remove the source of the infection. That could not happen in Ireland because there was a fetal heartbeat present until her life was at risk. The problem with somebody's life being at risk is that their life is at risk. In other words, they may die, and Savita tragically died. We know there were deficiencies in her care, but had she been delivered earlier, the question of deficiencies later would not have arisen. She had an overwhelming sepsis, which was unresponsive to treatment, and she died. If she had lived in any other European country and not Ireland, she would almost certainly be alive today with a young family, and we would never have heard her. The second case, which we can be absolutely sure was never foreseen by those who voted for the Eighth Amendment back in 1983, was the case of Miss P. Miss P was a young mother of two small children. In December 2014, she had catastrophic and irreversible brain damage when she was 15 weeks pregnant. Her doctors were uncertain, because of the Eighth Amendment, as to whether or not they could turn off her support at the request of her family because there was a fetal heartbeat present. The case ended up in the High Court in the days before Christmas. Miss P was dead, but her organs were what was called somatically or artificially supported, while lawyers debated and argued what should happen. I was a medical witness in the case, and I cannot tell you how distressing it was to hear the pain and anguish of her family, in particular her small children. As her body swelled and deteriorated, her nurses applied makeup in an effort to hide what was happening for the sake of her children and her family who were at her bedside. This case was rightly described as grotesque, and it only happened because of the Eighth Amendment. Ireland was another country in 1983. I have colleagues who voted for the Eighth Amendment in good faith. Having seen the consequences, many tell me they never anticipated how to work in practice. And given the opportunity, they tell me they will vote for repeal on this occasion. So where do we go from here? The first thing to remember is that if the Eighth Amendment is repealed, the Protection of Life and Pregnancy Act of 2013 will continue to be the law. There will be no legal vacuum. If the Eighth Amendment is repealed, it will be the responsibility of our elected representatives in your office to legislators. As doctors, we in the Institute of Obstetricians and Gynecologists stand ready to advise our legislators on best medical practice. This is particularly important around the questions of rape, viability, and fetal anomaly. There's no diagnostic test for rape. My colleagues who work in this area have been very clear about this. And we cannot re-traumatize women who are pregnant as a result of rape. As doctors, we want to see that legislation for termination of pregnancy for health reasons will provide protection for babies born from the time of viability. That is the time at which survival outside the womb is a realistic possibility. A team of neonatal doctors should be present at any delivery from the time of viability onwards to assess the prospects of survival and to offer treatment when appropriate. And that can be switched to legislation if necessary. Finally, my colleagues have been clear that we believe that we should be able to offer the same pathway of care to couples of women who tragically discover that their baby has a condition that means that he or she will die at or soon after birth. I emphasize I'm not talking about disability, which is specifically excluded from the proposed legislation. The cases I'm talking about are cases where, for example, the brain, as with Jerry and Gay and Adam Cafferty, or the kidneys just don't develop, and the baby will die no matter at what stage of pregnancy he or she is delivered. Some of our patients choose to continue with the pregnancy to term. That's their choice, and they receive all the care they need, including hospice care for the baby when it is born. And they receive that here in this country. Many describe this choice as the right one for them, and I would have personal experience of that with patients I've looked after. However, there are other couples for whom the right choice for them is not to continue the pregnancy to term. At the moment, because of the Eighth Amendment, we cannot give them the same standard of care. We can only stand by while they travel to another country, and we've all heard their heartbreaking stories today included. Abortion is a difficult issue. However, the time has come for us to deal with it ourselves in Ireland. Every other European country has found a solution which works for them. We can no longer rely on others. The hospital in Liverpool, which looks after many of our women, closed its doors to Irish women recently for a period of 2 weeks. They then opened them again on a limited basis. And that is coming down the line. Women will be denied access to English hospitals at some stage in the future. This is an Irish problem, and we need to get our own Irish solution. As a mature nation, it's time for us to take responsibility ourselves and repeal the Eighth Amendment. Thank you.
He's always such a rock of good sense, isn't he? An Irish problem, we need an Irish solution. Could I now invite each of our three co-directors to say a few words?
Thank you, Martina, and thank you to everybody for coming together to launch Together4Yes. I'm going to say a little bit about who we are. So Together4Yes is the national civil society campaign to remove the Eighth Amendment from our Constitution. We are the broadest platform ever assembled to create a more compassionate Ireland that cares for its women by providing abortion care to those who need it. Together4Yes is made up of organisations, groups and communities representing a diverse cross-section of Irish civil society. We are a movement which has support in every community, village and town in Ireland. And this is indicative of the fact that the overwhelming majority of Irish people want to change our abortion laws because they are too restrictive and they harm women. We represent people who believe that Ireland is a compassionate country, and that our laws should support, respect, and protect women in their time of greatest need. Together4Yes is co-led by the National Women's Council of Ireland, the Coalition to Repeal the Eighth Amendment, and the Abortion Rights Campaign. And at the heart of our campaign are the experiences of women and their families. And we are focused on achieving laws and services that respond to women's needs and to best medical practice. The Together4Yes campaign respects the diverse views people hold on this issue. We absolutely understand that this is a complex and a sensitive issue for many. But we also know that sometimes a personal and a private matter needs public support. We know that life is not black and white. It is sometimes grey and complex. And we believe that the Constitution is not the place to address the complexities of a crisis pregnancy. We believe this decision is a personal and a private one, that one that a woman should be allowed to make under the care and support of her doctor and of her family. This referendum is a critical juncture for Ireland, and we invite everyone who wish to create a compassionate environment for women who need abortion in Ireland to join with us in this campaign. Together we can make a real difference to women's lives by removing the Eighth Amendment, and we can bring an end to the pain and distress of women shut out by their own country. We are now together. We are Together4Yes.
Are coming together with over 70 groups representing every facet of Irish life. Together4Yes is the Irish Family Planning Association, the Rape Crisis Network Ireland, Women's Aid, Terminations for Medical Reasons, Parents for Choice, the Dublin Well Women Centre, Akidwa, the Union of Students of Ireland, One Family, Doctors for Choice, trade unions, and many more. In launching today, we are inviting all civil society organisations to sign up and to work with us in shaping our future for ourselves and for our children. From day one, this movement for change has been built on the work of volunteers, and it's wonderful to see so many of you in the room here today. Winning this referendum will rely on that same work again. Together4Yes have local campaign groups in every county, and it's vital that this work on the ground continues and builds over the coming weeks. We are a campaign of thousands of individuals all over Ireland, and we're asking you to join us. Sign up to Together4Yes on our website, join your local canvassing group and help mobilise in your community. Organise a fundraiser or a coffee morning. Donate to the campaign. Most importantly of all, start conversations with your neighbours, with your family, with your friends, in your workplace. Now is the time to engage. Now is the time to speak up and to tell people why you will be voting yes and what it will mean to you. Because we're all coming together for yes for many reasons. We are together for yes because the Eighth Amendment has hurt those closest to us. We are together for yes because we have travelled. We are together for yes for all the stories left untold. We are together for yes because our hands are tied when treating our patients. We are together for yes to support a woman's private and personal decision. We are together for yes for a compassionate, caring Ireland where women can access the healthcare they need. We are together for yes.
After 35 years, we're on our way. And together, we will be a vibrant, vigorous, honest, fact-based campaign, encouraging people all over this country to get together for yes. We'll be a broad, welcoming, inclusive campaign. And yes, we will, as always, be respectful of people's positions and views, whatever they are. We know that talking about abortion can be a tough challenge for people, that a lot of people do have worries and fears. But we also know, from talking with our own families, with our friends, our neighbours, in our communities, on the doorsteps and at the street stalls, as well as from all the polling and the research, we know that people want to put an end to the suffering and distress, to end these lonely journeys that women have to make across the sea to England, an end to the bleakness of a woman taking abortion pills on her own in secret because she can't get the care that she needs here at home in Ireland. People want to put an end to the harm and the real cruelty of the Eighth Amendment. So our messages are crystal clear. Three C's: care, compassion, and change. Women. Be able to have the care and the support they need, including access to abortion here in Ireland. And we can and we must respond with compassion to the reality of women's lives. Abortions happen. They happen here. That's a fact. And we must put in place laws and services to respond compassionately and appropriately to women's real life needs. The only way we can move to provide that care, that compassion, those services, the only way we can do that is by voting yes to remove the Eighth Amendment, voting yes to change. This referendum matters, I believe, to absolutely all of us, men and women in this country. We're campaigning for a fairer, and I think for a kinder, Ireland. A place where women's lives and health are truly respected and protected. An Ireland that we're proud to live in and a good place to raise our children and also our grandchildren. The time for change has come, and we are more than ready and willing and able to rise to that challenge. Vote yes to end an unforgiving and a harsh, punitive past. Vote yes for a kinder, more open and honest Ireland now. And vote yes for the future, for the generations to come. Together, we can do it.
She's a former Supreme Court judge and the first woman to hold the office of Circuit Court Judge in Ireland. In 2015, the Children's Rights Alliance established the Catherine McGuinness Fellowship in her honour, acknowledging her work as a children's champion.
For your kind welcome, and it's great to see this wonderful crowd here this morning. I can remember, because I'm old enough to have been there the first time round, how we used to go in 1983 to talk to a meeting looking to prevent the enactment of the Eighth Amendment, and seeing four or five supporters at the back of the hall who would be the people who would dare come out in a rural Irish village to support you. So to see this big room full of people to support the Together4Yes is a wonderful welcome. This gathering and this campaign is the second time round, or a repeat experience for me. I was very much involved and active in the campaign against the introduction of the Eighth Amendment in 1983. I was then a member of Shannon Aaron, and like many of my fellow members of the Oireachtas at that time, and members of the Shannon, including indeed our present president, we argued that the proposed amendment was wrong for both legal and social reasons, and for medical reasons. This was despite the no doubt sincere beliefs of its advocates. The amendment, we felt, would not achieve its own purported aim, but would in fact become an instrument of oppression of women and uncertainty for the medical profession. Legislation, through the normal processes of the Oireachtas, was the place for regulation of termination of pregnancy, as was the case with other medical and health matters. And that's still the case today. All that happened since 1983 has not made me change my mind. Indeed, the sad tales of the cases that have unfolded from the X case onward over the past 35 years have only strengthened and confirmed my original beliefs. You have heard Dr. Boylan speaking of the tragic medical cases that have ensued. While it has not the same compassionate need, the legal cases were equally disturbing because they distorted the law in order to try and help the people who were involved. And the work of the amendment was criticized by many judicial minds at the time. As I say, the tale of the past 35 years has only strengthened and confirmed my original beliefs. I am, therefore, a determined supporter of the Yes campaign this time round, and in particular for Together4Yes, because it's great to see all these different groups coming together, representing all different threads of people who want to see the repeal of the Eighth Amendment. It's essential for us as Irish citizens, as Irish people, to accept the reality that we have abortion in Ireland. Technically, it may take place in Britain, perhaps in the Netherlands, or it may take place through obtaining the relevant bill online from the internet, and taking him without medical care, without medical supervision. It is, to put it nicely, it is a fairy tale, or to put it more crudely, it is utter hypocrisy to believe that this is not so. We have heard the list of the people who travel from every county in Ireland and from every day in Ireland to avail of services in other jurisdictions. And we know the level of the seeking of relief through the pill. Making abortion hard to talk about does not mean that it does not happen. To continue the pretense and the silence has, as Billy Kelleher points out in his excellent article in yesterday's Irish Times, has had an enduring negative effect on women's health and well-being. And I know that those people from the Oireachtas who are here today would agree with him in what he has said. The time has come for us to accept that this is the world of Ireland of 2018 and to act accordingly by voting for the repeal of the Eighth Amendment. I am, of course, aware that many people have a sincere belief that abortion is wrong in all circumstances. Those of us who seek change do not lack respect for such a belief and should be willing to express such respect, as Alva has said. But we are not asking anyone to abandon such a belief in their personal behaviour. We are asking them in turn to respect the opinions and the desire of those who are equally sincere in respecting and trusting other women's different decisions in looking for abortion. We are asking them to turn away from a law which has driven other women into flight, deception and secrecy. And this is very clear from Dr. Boylan's speech. Obviously, I'm not asking for, as it were, lawless situations if the amendment is repealed, and we need to look at the need to change the Protection of Life and Pregnancy Act, which I recall speaking to the Health Committee about under the chairmanship of Jerry Buttermer. The Oireachtas is, but one can see that we are seeking a properly regulated medical service governed by legislation. It has become clear that our legislators are well capable of treating this as a cross-party matter, as one could see from the deliberations of the Oireachtas Committee, so well chaired by Senator Noonan, and it's great to see her here today. Expressed opinions, because in a small country we have the good fortune to have easy access to them, so that we can foresee that it is possible to introduce precisely the kind of properly legalized abortion system, whether through medical intervention or through the abortion pill, to have it in a proper way regulated with proper support, both for women who choose abortion and for women who, in another circumstance, choose not to avail of it and choose to maintain a pregnancy, even in the tragic circumstances described by our couple so movingly earlier this morning. So I know this sounds like an appeal of saying, trust your politicians, and people kind of say, what? I myself started working in the Oireachtas in the 1960s, if you can believe it could be so long ago as that. And believe you, they're not such a bad crowd, really, when you come to keep them and you see that there are a large number of them who are willing to work together with, like Together4Yes, together among the different political parties. So that I think we are, you know, we should encourage them and influence them in the right direction for what we're looking for after what I hope will be the repeal of the 8th. So I would add to what Alba has said by a plea for respectful debate and for regard for reality and for truth. Past debates on this subject have been dominated by extremes, and this time I think we also need to have space of middle ground for the moderate voice, for the people who may be a bit unsure but still realise that keeping the law bound in the shackles of the 8th Amendment is the wrong road to take. This has created difficulties, for instance, in broadcasting, where broadcasts have tended to be just two people from the opposite ends shouting at each other and nothing emerging that makes much sense, just antagonism. So we need to be able to have a system which allows reasonable, respectful, rational discussion that explains the various issues. I'm asking this because, like others who campaigned in 1983, we can well remember the utter misery of that campaign. Let that not happen again. So I'm concluding just by saying, here we are this morning, a whole several generations, and I have to admit that my grandson is out every day canvassing already. I'm just encouraging all of you and everybody in Ireland to look at this in the reality of what Ireland's situation is today, in the reality of the abortion that we already have, and let us have a proper system to surround this with medical care, with social care, and with the general health of families and the population. So really it's just get out there and vote, and vote Together4Yes. Thank you.